Hello everybody, welcome to another installment of the Highlights Tour here at the Square Arboretum and Swarthmore campus. My name is Shem Ruszczyk. I'm an assistant garden supervisor, and today we'll be talking about everything from trees to shrubs, grasses, perennials that are really making a statement in the height of summer. All right, so here we are at the entrance garden to the Square Arboretum offices. And behind me are Angelica Gigas, the Korean Angelica. And you can see this mass grouping of these plants. They're a beautiful architectural plant, and they make this dramatic statement in as a group. They have these beautiful dark purple stems that are held up on these very stiff stems. The umbel flowers, I don't know if you can see all the pollinators flying behind us, but they attract a lot of pollinators as well. These plants are biennials, so they, you know, the first year they produce a rosette, and then they flower the second year. And you want to make sure the seeds ripen and fall off the plant if you want to continue that progression of the plant. So yeah, you make sure they ripen off, and then the little seedlings will germinate and you'll have a continual production of plants for many years to come. Okay, here we are with Persicaria virginiana, a painter's palette. Common name, knotweed. It's, you know, related to the weed you would find in the woods. But this particular selection has these beautiful marbled leaves. It's got this distinctive chevron marking from side to side of the leaflet. So yeah, a former teacher of mine said that flowers are fleeting, but foliage is forever. So this particular plant, you know, even though the flowers are a little inconspicuous, they're already faded, the foliage remains, and it just produces this beautiful, this mound of distinctive foliage that contrasts with other plants around it. You know, this plant grows to about 3 feet. It can be grown in porch shade and full sun as well. It's, you know, just needs average, well-draining soil to be thriving. So you can use this knotweed in mass grouping. It will naturalize a little bit, and it's, you know, well suited for cottage gardens and border plantings of mixed perennials as well. Okay, so here we are in the Terry Shane garden, and I just want to point out this beautiful hibiscus. It's got these almost 8-inch flowers, this with this magenta color that contrasts the beautiful foliage. And it's just a very well-placed plant. Behind it, you have the physocarpus, the hydrangeas, and the crepe myrtles. The hibiscus, it's one of the latest to emerge as a perennial. So in the spring, you want to cut back any dead kind of branches and let the new foliage emerge. But it's, you know, it's got this nice rounded form, stiff stems, it doesn't flop. This is the part of the Summerific series, so if you want to check those, Proven Winners has a bunch of those on sale. So yeah, you can choose from various colors and foliage types. But yeah, to promote flowering, you can deadhead the spent flowers as well. And yeah, this is you can use this as a specimen in your perennial border. It really has a wide array of uses in the landscape. Okay, so behind me we have hydrangea paniculata phantom. The panicle hydrangea is this is the largest flowering panicle hydrangea. So it's a vigorous plant. It grows to about 10, 12 feet, and the flowers are sometimes so heavy that the stems, you know, will flop a little bit, but you can see this is a very well-placed planting with the nine bark kind of supporting the heavy flower heads. This particular shrub, you want to cut back late winter, early spring, because it blooms on new wood. So you you want that new wood to establish and get rid of any spent wood that happened the previous season. Yeah, you can use it in a mixed border. It prefers full sun, but it will grow in part shade. So yeah, if you want a dramatic effect in your garden, these massive hydrangea flower heads will do the job. Okay, so yeah, as you can see above, right behind me, the Lagostromia Sue, the crepe myrtle, it's got these beautiful pink panicles, which average about 100 days of blooming in the summer from June to September. This crepe myrtles, you know, they can be used as small trees, as a single trunk specimen, or you can grow them as a multi-stemmed shrub, small tree as well. If you would like to grow them as a single trunk, just cut off the laterals to about 5 feet from the ground. So we'll produce that effect. Yeah, if you have power lines in your home, you can use that below them because it will only reach about 20 feet. It's got beautiful exfoliating bark, just a very adaptable plant. It won't be hardy in zone 5 or 6. Zone 6, it will have some winter dieback. So if you are growing it in that area, just you might have to do some damage control. But it will grow in 7 and 9 very reliably. And it is susceptible to deer browse. So just be aware of that if you live in an area with a lot of deer browsing. So here's another hydrangea paniculata. This one is DVP Pinky or Pinky Winky. And yeah, I just want to highlight these hydrangeas because these are very well performing plants in any garden setting. This two-toned panicle, it's got, you know, these light pink bracts coupled with, you know, white flowers that really create this whimsical look. And this particular one, you know, it's more open and kind of more stout than the Phantom. If you have a smaller space, this would be a better selection for that area. It's more open, more compact. The flower heads aren't as big, so you won't get that flopping with the fan as you do with the Phantom. Like all paniculatas, they grow on new wood, so cut them back late winter, early spring, and yeah, you'll get these beautiful profusions of panicles that turn slightly more pinkish as the fall approaches. Okay, here's another hydrangea. This one's a pretty unique one, Hydrangea aspera burgundy bliss, the plum passion hydrangea. As the common name kind of suggests, it's got these plum tones on the stems, on the other side of the leaves. Yeah, the delicate lace cap blooms have pink sterile flowers that are pink to mauve, and these more lavender type fertile flowers. It does need more shade than your paniculatas, but it will take some morning sun as well. Mature plants will grow up to about 6-7 feet tall, and like it's not very cold hardy, so zone 6 is kind of pushing it. You might need a protected location if you're in zone 6. But it will tolerate a large range of soils, and it's pretty adaptable in the garden. You can use it in a group setting, like an edge of a woodland, or it makes a good specimen like it does in this Terry Shane garden. All right, and here we are with Euchomys camosa, the pineapple lily. It's a pretty unusual perennial. It's got this rosette of wine-colored leaves. They are very bold, that, you know, they make a great contrast with this kind of fine textured carex that's underneath it. The flower spikes are pretty unique. They'll reach about 2 feet tall with these multiple little florets on among the inflorescence. It's a good container plant, so if you have some container displays you want to beef up and make unique, this is a good selection. It's just a great addition to a perennial border. Here we are with Physocygia virginiana, the obedient plant. It's a U.S. native. It's a rhizomatous perennial, so this clump, it will naturalize somewhat by rhizomes. So it's a good, you can use it in meadows, prairies, and you know, perennial borders as well. But it, you know, it's called obedient plant because to me, you know, it kind of stands, all the stems stand like a soldier. They're very obedient. They don't really flop. It's a very tidy plant with these beautiful spikes of pink to, you know, purple flowers. The flowers will start blooming on each little floret from the bottom to the top. It needs well-draining soil. It prefers sandy soil, but it will tolerate a wide range of conditions. Grow in full sun because it does need full sun to thrive. And it will tolerate deer as well as clay soils. And it's got a long blooming period from June to September. So it's a, you know, very versatile plant that will provide architecture in the garden and as well as a long blooming period. So here we are in the rose garden, and I just want to point out a very well performing perennial. This is Euphorbia corollata, the flowering spurge. It's got a 6-week flowering period, so it's very reliable. It's a great performer, and it provides this airy appearance to it. And the white flowers really soften the palette a little bit because you have these warm colors in the rose garden. So these white flowers really like let your eye rest when you're moving around and seeing all the hot colors of the roses. The euphorbia, as all other euphorbias, has milky sap in it in the stems. So when you're working with it and you break the stems, just make sure you don't get it on your skin because it will cause irritation. Another fact about this perennial, it attracts an endangered butterfly, the kernel blue. So in addition to it, you know, its beauty, it provides ecological value as well. And it's pretty, you know, very adaptable. You can grow in the full sun, wide-ranging soil types. And yeah, we use it in the borders of the rose garden, like I said, to provide that contrast of softness to the color palette that is here. Here we are at Singer Hall in the hardwood swamp region. This region is it's part of the New Jersey Palm Barrens, and it's exemplified by obviously hardwoods and various other perennials and carex. So here I just want to highlight Rexia virginica, the meadow beauty. How it's a beautiful flower. It naturalizes, and it's used in, you know, these kind of sandy, swampy settings. You can find it in the hardwood region of the New Jersey Pine Barrens. The showy flowers are in loose terminals. It's got one pistil and it's surrounded by 8 stamens. And even after the flower fades, the seed vessels are perfect cream pitchers of a very graceful form. And that's a quote by Thoreau, who saw the plant growing in its native habitat. You can grow it in wet meadows, in part shade and sandy peaty soil, and it will tolerate full sun as well. So a great combination for the Rexia is the Aragrostis spectabilis, the purple lovegrass. This airy bunch warm season grass tolerates very poor soils, and it grows very well in the sandy kind of wet regions that the Pine Barrens are known for. And yeah, it pairs very well with the Rexia. It makes great dry arrangements. These airy seed heads are perfect for flower arrangements. This will reseed very easily. But when you're doing your weeding in the spring and the early summer, the little rosette will resemble crabgrass. So the way to distinguish that is the rosette, I don't know if I can find any, but it's very tomentous, like hairy on the stem. So that's a good ID characteristic between crabgrass and the purple lovegrass. But yeah, it will naturalize. We let it reseed throughout this region, and it creates this, you know, this mass effect of very airy, fine textured foliage that provides contrast to the more broad-leafed, bold foliage plants. All right, so here's a dramatic display of Rudbeckia hirta, the black-eyed Susan. This is a first-year meadow installation at the Whittier, it's called the Whittier Meadow. And yeah, the black-eyed Susans, typically in this kind of setting, the first year, they will really, really be aggressive until the other perennials have a chance to bulk up and outcompete this perennial. So it does reseed, and a lot of people treat it as an annual, but you know, it will persist for a couple years in this kind of setting. But eventually this meadow will transition into a more varied, diverse group of plants as the other perennials get established. This is, you know, this withstands deer browsing, and the cone flowers are kind of pronounced. It's got this beautiful burnt orange kind of yellow ray flower, and it is susceptible to mildew, as you can see here. But you know, if you give it more air circulation, it should help with that issue. And I just love how this planting complements the architecture of the Whittier Hall behind me. All right, so midsummer, the plants that really shine are these ornamental grasses. And here in the Nason Garden, it really exemplifies these grasses, because it's a garden that's focused on texture. So in addition to all the bold foliage, there is a lot of beautiful ornamental grasses. This particular one, Buteleuma gracilis, Blonde Ambition, is the blue gramma grass. And it's got these very unique horizontal, kind of like eyelash-shaped seed heads that will persist for a while. They got very, very stiff stems, so they won't flop on you and fold. And behind me, you have another excellent performer, Calamagrostis ex acutiflora, Carl Forrester. This particular grass, it's widely used in many landscape applications. It won perennial plant of the year in 2001 because of its strong stems, the long-lasting plumes, its upright habit. It's, you know, the wheat-colored seed head is the first to bloom of all the grasses, and will tolerate heavy clay soil and compact soils. So its adaptability, its grace and beauty, really just, it's a, you know, an overall very well-performing grass. And, you know, as we move on, you can see how the gardeners here are using it to hold up the Rudbeckia subtomentosa Henry Eilers. And that's a unique Rudbeckia. It's the sweet cone flower. It blooms from July to September. The ray flowers are separated. They have this space between them that makes them pretty unique. And they're slightly aromatic. They have a slight fragrance to them. But yeah, this is a great combination of this fine textured grass. You have the Eupatorium behind the Jopai weed. And it just creates a very, very nice garden design. Yeah, another beautiful grass in the Nason Garden is Sorghastrum Newtons, Golden Sunset. It's the it's a common grass native to our region. This Indian grass, kind of like the Carl Forrester, is upright. It's got very stiff stems and this beautiful golden sunset seed heads. It's, you know, a clump-forming warm season grass. It will attract butterflies. It's a larval host for the pepper and skipper butterfly. The foliage is also pretty distinctive. It's got olive green leaf blades, and it's very cold hardy. It will grow in even zone 3. The drought tolerance also makes it very adaptable, but it will reseed a little bit, so you know, just be mindful, but it shouldn't be a problem. It can be used in a meadow setting, a prairie, or an accent in a perennial border. So yeah, I highly suggest using this grass in your garden. So here I am with a very unique tree. You know, we talked about a lot of kind of your staple plants, your reliable hydrangeas and crepe myrtles, but it'll probably be hard to press to find this in the trade. This is Euscaphis japonica, the Korean sweetheart tree. It's growing here on the side of Beardsley Hall. And even though the flowers are pretty inconspicuous, they don't really put on a show, this is really when the tree shines. It's got these beautiful, the fruit is ripening right now, and it's called the Korean sweetheart tree because of the heart-shaped seed vessels. So yeah, it's a very distinct fruit that it's very conspicuous. The leaves are also beautiful, these opposite kind of compound leaves that turn purple to red in the fall. This tree, you know, this particular specimen's probably, you know, 25, 30 feet tall. It's, you know, it'll tolerate drought, but it's better with consistent moisture. And this, the Euscaphis is a monotypic genus, so it's got only one species in the whole entire genus. And we have to mention the best performing phlox at the Mount Cuba trials, Phlox paniculata gina. This particular phlox attracted the most butterflies in the trial. It also has slightly fragrant flowers, which is why it is here in the fragrance garden. You can treat it as, you know, do the Chelsea chop on it in late May, early June, so it doesn't flap as much. But overall, this is a one perennial plant association plant of the year. So it's got very, very good attributes. It doesn't get powdery mildew, which was one of its distinct features. This was a selection that was discovered near Nashville, Tennessee, along a riverbank. So it's been propagated and is available now in the trade. So it will tolerate heat and drought, some shade in the afternoon. You can deadhead the spent blooms to prolong flowering period. It does make a great cut flower, and it's, you know, you can use it in the perennial mixed border. With the long blooming season, it's a really great performer. It will attract tons of butterflies to your garden space. And it's got, yeah, the great ecological value as well as the great ornamental value. It makes it a wonderful selection. Here's a pretty unique perennial. It's a clump-forming native to meadows of open ground in Northeast Asia. It has a very long blooming period from June to September. And the name of it is Calamaris incisa, blue star is the cultivar. You know, it's got an asteraceous flower that resembles other asters. You can grow it in zones 5 to 9. It prefers moist to dry conditions, so it's very adaptable. It can take hot and humid summers. Pinching it back in early summer will promote more flowering and keep it compact, not that it's not, but it will, you know, produce those lateral flower shoots. And you can use it in a group planting like we are doing here in the peony collection on the edge of borders. It'd be a great plant for a rock garden as well. And yeah, it's a pretty unique genus that I haven't heard till I saw it here. All right, here behind me is Franklinia alatamaha. I believe I'm pronouncing that correctly. So yeah, it has a great story. It was discovered by John Bartram growing along the Alatamaha River in Southeast Georgia. And seeds were collected. They were brought back to Bartram Gardens where it was germinated and successfully grown. And currently it's extinct in nature. So the only specimens are growing in botanic gardens and other institutions. So the showy fragrant flower is very beautiful. It's got this subtle sweet scent to it. It will bloom from July to August, and in full sun to part shade. It does require very good drainage, so make sure you're not planting it in clay soils. And yeah, it's just a great specimen tree. Even the unopened buds are very ornamental. It's got beautiful kind of striated bark and really nice glossy big leaves as well. So highly recommend you seeking this out in the trade and growing it in your garden. Well, I will be remiss if I didn't mention the surprise lily, Lycoris squadjimera. It's growing here in these masses on McGill Walk. And the surprise lily, it's called that because the foliage emerges in the spring and dies back in the summer. So for a few months there, you don't know that anything is there. And all of a sudden you get this 2 foot, 3 foot naked stalk with these beautiful profusion of flowers. So because it does create kind of a messy look with the foliage dying back, it's good to use it in a kind of a meadow setting. I mean, here we're using plants like the ferns, epimediums, hellebores, amsonias to hide that messy foliage in the summer. And yeah, this particular species is the most cold hardy of the surprise lilies. So you can grow it in zone 5. If you're planting it, plant the bulbs about 6 inches deep and 6 inches apart, and they will naturalize by themselves and create this beautiful effect in your garden. All right, well, thank you for joining us on this August Highlights tour. I hope you learned some things, saw some interesting plants. And if you want to see them in person, I encourage you to come visit our Arboretum, the campus grounds.